Welcome to part five of FDA product regulation. I will focus on the licensing applications for drug and biologics. My name is Betsy Valenti, and I've been with the FDA for 17 years. I'm currently the Governance and Modernization Project Manager in the Office of Regulatory Operations at the Center for Biologics Research, or Center for Biologics Evaluation and Research. Whether a drug or a biologic, the FDA has standards that must be met for approved products that we regulate. The standards include safety, purity, potency, stability, and product quality. Together, these standards are known as CGMP, or current good manufacturing processes. You will see this woven through the licensing aspects in the coming slides. When an applicant wants to introduce a new drug or biological product into interstate commerce, they must submit an application, which we refer to as NDAs and BLAs. An application to the FDA must contain adequate information for a substantive review. That includes administrative information, such as the applicant's contact information, which is submitted on Form FDA 356H. That form must accompany every drug or biological licensing submission, whether it's a new application or not. The application must also contain pertinent data to support the requested indication, including clinical, product, and statistical data, pharmacology and toxicology data, proposed labeling, samples for testing, and exclusivity and financial information. All content must be in a standard common technical document format and indexed for the ease of navigating the file. For a standard new application, we have a 12-month review clock to complete our review of the file. These review clocks are set by user fee agreements between industry and the FDA. Most NDAs and BLAs are regulated under PDUFA, or the Prescription Drug User Fee Act. Drugs and biologics must follow the regulations set out in 21 CFR 314. However, biologics must meet additional regulations that are in 21 CFR 601. For biologics, applicants must submit non-clinical laboratory and clinical studies that demonstrate safety, purity, and potency, a full description of manufacturing methods, stability data to support the requesting dating period or expiration date, product samples for testing, summaries of product testing, all proposed labeling, including the prescribing information and the carton and container packaging, contact information for all locations involved in all steps of the manufacturing process, and financial statements for all clinical investigators, and a claim for categorical exclusion or an environmental assessment for the potential risk or impacts to the human environment. The FDA regulates 20% of the US's gross domestic product, emphasizing the importance of the work we do. The risk-benefit evaluation is critical and continuous during a product's lifetime. The FDA continues to identify new risks and manage known risks, prevent adulteration of products through inspections and of manufacturing facilities and monitoring of labeling and promotional advertising materials, and conducts post-marketing surveillance for product safety and clinical efficacy. Regulating biological products brings its own unique challenges. Biologics are large, multifaceted, complex products. Because they are made or derived from living cells, maintaining quality of the final product can be difficult. It requires stability testing to detect changes in identity, purity, and potency. And because all biological products are different, and due to constant innovation in product development, it can be difficult to advise a company during development or to regulate a new class of products that we do not have a prior precedent for. Additionally, many biological products can be used to treat small populations, which makes it difficult to conduct clinical trials and gather sufficient safety and efficacy data. Biosimilars or interchangeables are the biologic equivalent of generic drugs. For a product to be designated as a biosimilar, it must be compared to a reference product that was evaluated and approved through our standard BLA review processes. In order to market a biosimilar, the applicant must demonstrate that it's highly similar to the reference product, including any of its inactive components, and in regard to safety, purity, and potency. The Orphan Drug Act defines a rare disease or as a disease or condition that affects less than 200,000 people in the United States. If a drug or biologic is intended to treat a rare disease or intended to treat more than 200,000 people, but the manufacturer is not expected to recover the development and manufacturing costs, then the FDA may designate it as an orphan drug. Orphan drug status can be very beneficial to manufacturers because it waives the prescription drug user fee. The fee to submit an NDA or BLA was over $3 million for fiscal year 2022. Orphan drug status also gives the manufacturer market exclusivity for 7 years. In addition, the FDA has voucher programs. The FDA can issue priority review vouchers at the time of approval for certain drugs and biologics intended to treat neglected tropical diseases, rare pediatric diseases, or for medical countermeasures. The number of vouchers varies from year to year, but it is trending upward. As you can see, fewer vouchers are redeemed than those that are issued. A priority review decreases an NDA or BLA review clock from 12 months down to 8 months, which speeds a drug to market. This voucher is an incentive for manufacturers because they may not recoup the cost associated with developing these products. The voucher can be used for any future submission and may also be sold to another entity. Post-approval changes to NDAs and BLAs are referred to as supplements. The type of supplement an applicant submits depends on the data and potential impact of the change. Supplements should be submitted to the FDA as the appropriate supplement type. If after initial review, the FDA determines the supplement type is not correct, it may upgrade or downgrade the submission type. There are 3 types of prior approval supplements, 2 types of changes being affected, and annual reports. We'll cover each of these supplement types. Efficacy supplements are the type that has the longest review clock, which is typically 10 months. Just about any supplement that contains human clinical data is characterized as an efficacy supplement. The data is evaluated to support the applicant's request to add a new indication or modify an existing indication. Changes to dose or regimen to add a new route of administration, establish comparability efficacy claims, expand the intended patient population, or to provide confirmatory data for a product that was approved by the accelerated approval pathway. Labeling supplements are on a 6-month review clock and are for changes to a package insert or carton and container labeling that do not require clinical data to support the proposed change. Data generated from post-marketing requirements or commitments or data to add or strengthen safety information may be submitted as a labeling supplement. Chemistry, manufacturing, and controls, or manufacturing supplements, are required to make changes to a product. The FDA evaluates these changes to determine if a product's identity, strength, quality, purity, or potency is negatively affected. The potential for adverse effects determines the type of manufacturing supplement that should be submitted. A manufacturing PAS contains a proposed change that has substantial potential to adversely affect a product and must be reviewed and approved by the FDA prior to implementation. Such changes could be a new facility, changes to source material, or a new comparability protocol. Manufacturing PASs are typically reviewed on a 4-month clock. A CBE 30 submission contains a proposed change that has a moderate potential to affect product safety. 30 days after submission, the applicant may implement the proposed changes unless otherwise notified by the FDA. We use those first 30 days to ensure the change would not substantially impact product safety. If there is a concern, we'll notify the applicant to not implement the change, and we may upgrade the submission to a PAS. Full review of a CBE 30 is completed in 6 months. Changes with a moderate potential to affect product safety include a new working cell bank, alternate approved filling lines, moderate changes to procedures or equipment, and alternate testing sites. A CBE also contains proposed changes with moderate potential to impact product safety, but less so. The applicant may implement the proposed changes immediately after submission to the FDA. Changes with a moderate potential to affect product safety include a new area for labeling or packaging, or a minor modification to a building's HVAC system. Full review of a CBE is completed in 6 months. And now on to the annual reports. After approval, all products must have an annual report submitted within 60 days of the approval anniversary date. Annual reports should contain changes that have a minimal potential to have an adverse impact. These changes could be minor changes to labeling, manufacturing, controls, equipment and facilities used in the manufacturing process, changes to responsible personnel, or data from sterility testing. There are not reportable PDUFA milestones for annual reports. However, we strive to complete an initial review in 3 months to ensure that additional data is not needed and the contents are appropriate for an annual report. We complete the review within 6 months. Post-approval, there are post-marketing requirements and commitments that applicants must meet to refine the safety, efficacy, or optimal use of a product, or to ensure consistent and reliable product quality. Applicants are required to submit adverse event reports to the FDA, whether or not that event is considered related to the approved product. An applicant is required to report within 15 days of receiving any initial information if an adverse event was both serious and unexpected. Adverse event reports are monitored to determine if there are safety issues, which could prompt a facility inspection, enforcement of safety measures, or education to patients or healthcare providers. During the review of an application, the FDA may seek a commitment or require the applicant to conduct additional clinical trials or studies as a condition of approval. Applicants may face legal penalties for not fulfilling post-marketing requirements or PMRs. Post-marketing commitments, or PMCs, are agreed to in writing between the FDA and the applicant. The FDA publicly reports the status of PMCs and PMRs, which is an incentive for applicants to fulfill their agreements. Also, the FDA can require, or the applicant may volunteer, to implement a REMS, or a risk evaluation and mitigation strategy, to prevent, monitor, or manage a specific known risk of a drug or biologic. Over the past few decades, the FDA's authority for PMCs and PMRs has grown. The Food and Drug Administration Modernization Act of 1997 required applicants to annually report the status of their clinical and non-clinical PMCs and PMRs, and for the FDA to track and report on all PMCs and PMRs annually in the Federal Register. The Pediatric Research and Equity Act of 2003 required research into pediatric uses of drugs and biologics. Now, under the FDA Amendments Act of 2007, the FDA can require non-clinical PMRs, also referred to as safety-related product quality studies, clinical studies or trials, REMS, or labeling changes after approval if new safety information becomes available. The FDA conducts active post-marketing pharmacovigilance under the Sentinel system and the Adverse Event Reporting System database. Quarterly reports of any new safety information or potential signals of serious risks identified for products are publicly posted quarterly. FDA also authorized the FDA to require REMS to ensure a drug or biological benefit outweighs the risk. The FDA may also require a REMS if new safety information becomes available post-approval. At any time, an applicant may voluntarily submit a REMS. This concludes the section on licensing applications for drugs and biologics. Thank you.